having dinner there because they are the Newfield donors. And they are the reason we are all here tonight. So can I have a hand for all the Newfield donors who have given so much to bring this orchestra to you tonight? So thank you again for being here. Thank you for being for troopers, for coming inside. Next week, we will be back outside, weather permitting. And it is the music of Chicago. And this band is awesome with a big, huge brass section. So we hope to see you next week outside. We also on Thursday night have a jazz show. But tonight, we are here to see this amazing orchestra, the new Philharmonic Orchestra, and Maestro Kirk Muspratt. So ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our concertmaster, Mark Egnor.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Good evening and welcome to our concert. For those of you that are watching us all over the world as we send this out over the airwaves, this is the New Philharmonic, the professional orchestra of Western Chicago. And this is our beautiful Belushi Performance Hall in the great Mackininch Theater, named after Dr. Mackininch, who's sitting right here. Yes, wonderful Dr. Mackininch. Tonight, we hope to provide you with many different styles and genres of music. We're going to play you some light classical music from Italy, France, and Austria. We're going to play you some ballet, some operetta, some musicals, some film music. We're going to play you some patriotic music. And we are going to play you some music about the moon. Yes, good. As always, I hope as you leave the concert, come back. I'll be out in the lobby. Come and tell me what you liked, what you wanted to hear more of, what you thought of the concert. That's very, very important to me. The first piece on the program tonight was a piece by the famous composer Johann Strauss. It is opus 373, and it's called the Auf der Jagd Polka, or the Hunt Polka. And the reason in 1875, when it was written, that they called it the Hunt Polka was that the percussionists were all given pistols to shoot off during the polka. We decided to not do that tonight, especially during donor appreciation evening. That's not a good idea. We're going to play you some French music now, and the reason is, as you met our friends from France, hello, Gwen, how are you? Ça va? All good? Yeah? Good. Yeah. So, the orchestra has a request for you, okay? If you can tell everybody. We understand that you're from the Bordeaux region of France, yes? And they asked as a sign of friendship if you could leave a couple of cases of the... before you leave tonight, okay? It's a very hot day and these people need to be hydrated. Okay, in one way or another. Okay, so we're going to play some Massenet for you from the great opera Le Cid from 1885. And of course, we all know that it's about the great warrior, the 11th century warrior. In all French operas, in the third act, there's always a ballet. It doesn't matter if it's about a Tyrannosaur or a Rex, or it's about Cinderella. So this is music from the ballet, and it's a piece called Navarrez. Thank you. So there are 16 pieces on the program. We had one rehearsal this afternoon for 2 hours and 12 minutes. I had 3 minutes left on the clock. So I just want you to know that's what kind of orchestra it is. And it's amazing because we just played through each piece once and that kind of band. How is the French music? Not marvelous, not fabulous, nothing, just fine. Wow, unbelievable. Excellent, right. He's like Pepe Le Pew. Ah, there you go, okay. We're going to change gears now, okay? We're going to, next year, New Philharmonic Opera is going to play the luscious and gorgeous and hilarious operetta by Franz Lehár, The Merry Widow. And the costumes will be fantastic, the lighting will be fantastic, the singers, always from our Chicagoland, are first class. And our soloist that we're going to bring out now has sung several main roles with us just in the last several operas. She was Violetta in the Traviata, she was Rosalinda in Fledermaus, and next year she is going to play in The Merry Widow, Valencien, who has the unfortunate choice in her life to be married to a total moron, like really just an incompetent guy named Baron Zeta, okay? Catherine is going to sing the most famous aria from The Merry Widow, and it's usually sung by another character. But we wanted to give you a taste of this beautiful and ravishing music by Lehár, and we wanted to give you a chance to hear the wonderful, wonderful Catherine Weber again. Would you please welcome her?
Oh,
part of what I'd like to do this evening is to take a set of pieces and commemorate what was going on 75 years ago. Because 75 years ago in 1944 and 1945, some of the most horrendous battles were going on in America. And I just think it's incumbent upon all of us to sort of remember that amazing, great generation and what went on then. So 75 years ago, on the island or the atoll of Guadalcanal, 7,000 Marines lost their lives. So, I mean, I think we should all think about that, especially 75 years ago when we have so few of those people left. A few years later, in 1952, after the war, NBC commissioned Richard Rodgers to write a series of the music for 26 half-hour shows on Sunday evening. And they were called Victory at Sea. And they started at the beginning of the war, and they went through what the Marines and the Navy did through the entire war, and that's 26. Of all those 26 nights of music, the greatest and most famous piece that came out of Victory at Sea was the Guadalcanal March. And I just want to tell you, it is the best. Thank you. At the same time, of course, as that was going on in the Pacific Theater, there were all sorts of things, for instance, like D-Day that just happened last month, 75 years ago. And up to that, of course, Africa and Italy, and finally the invasion of France and Holland and all that that went on then. For me personally, I gained much more insight into what went on at that time by watching Steven Spielberg's great, great film, Saving Private Ryan. It gave wonderful detail. It was fantastically done. And from that, John Williams wrote Hymn to the Fallen. And that's exactly what I think this piece is. It's reverent, and it is reflective, and it certainly is a hymn.
Thank you. In speaking to you at the dinner before, I realized there were people from all over the place here this evening. And but I people ask me, and you know, being Canadian, I have to tell you something. I have no understanding whatsoever of American football. I'm just telling you. The only thing that I truly know in my heart is that I love, 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 love the Green Bay Packers. The French people are going, what? Je ne comprends. Look, believe me, these people from Wisconsin are very nice, and just like you, the French people, they love cheese, okay? Yeah, okay. Okay, as I said, I know nothing about American football, but obviously, I'm sure that you do, okay? So what I want each of you to do is go back into your stats book and into your files for your knowledge of football in America, back to the 1906 collegiate year. Do you all remember it? It's a very famous year because in 1906, Navy had the very best team in America, okay? Eight of the teams that they played that year did not score 1 point on them. They outscored their opponents 147-14. In 1906. And then on the auspicious day that always happens in early December when there's that dastardly Army-Navy game, right? Lieutenant Charles Zimmerman, who is the band director, decided that he should write a new march for this wonderful team. And so it became later the official song of the U.S. Navy. It's called Anchors Away. As I finish this set of patriotic music and remembering 1943, 44, 45, those times, there's a song that I've loved since I was a little boy. I grew up in a little town, and there were all sorts of Irish and Scottish and Welsh and English people who spoke in funny accents, and they all played the piano, and they all sang, And I remember when I was a little boy, I heard this song. It was written in 1941, yes, during the Blitz and the Battle of Britain. And I always was stopped dead whenever I heard this song. So I hope you love it as much as I do. It is called The White Cliffs of Dover. And I'd like to invite our lovely Catherine back to sing it for you. She will be back. So of all the things we should be celebrating and commemorating and talking about is that tomorrow night, 50 years ago, America landed on the moon. Can you imagine the bravery of those three guys and all the designers and propellant guys and mathematicians and scientists and engineers and you name it? Yes, yes, all those people, astonishing. Yeah, and when you think that, Kennedy gave his challenge to America on May the 25th, 1961, and 8 years later, you were taking a man 250,000 miles away, 250,000 miles and back. That's like as bad as driving to Chicago. That's a long that's a long ways now, you know? That's really, you know. Okay, so this happened, in, of course, in 1969 in July. And just 9 months later, Apollo 13 took off with, again, three wonderful heroes. But as we all know, the mission was ill-fated because of a small technical error. But again, the brilliant people and the brave pilots brought everybody home safely. We know this also from the fantastic movie Apollo 13. James Horner wrote the music to Apollo 13, and we would like to play you some of that now.
Thank you.
That's Matthew, okay? And he needs a case of Bordeaux just for himself, okay? Okay. So from our success and our dreams coming true of landing a man on the moon, the next thing we had to think about was all the incarnations and the imaginations and things that were going to come from Captain Kirk and Spock and the crew of the Starship Enterprise. This is Star Trek.
Thank you.
two presidents in the House. I don't know, I understand you've met Dr. Hal Mackinac, who the building's named after, our longest reigning president, but who you may not have met is our new president, Dr. Brian Caputo. And if you haven't met him, I urge you at some point to say hello. He's very kind, he's very fair, he's very humble. He won't tell you that he is like this incredibly crazy award-winning CFO who's won tons of awards for his financial abilities and his practices and how he tightens things up. So rest assured, the money here is really safe. Really safe. We have a president who is a serious accountant. Everybody likes that. And we have another president here, Sherman, president of the College of DuPage Foundation, who raises all the money here. Thank you. Can you stand? Can you just wave? Another humble man. So I want to tell you about something that's going to happen tomorrow morning at 10 a.m. We're all coming back because anybody know what's happening tomorrow? Tickets go on sale. So when people see me in the street and go, I didn't know John Hyatt was sold out. I didn't know the Bodines were sold out. When did they go on sale? Tomorrow. All the tickets go on sale tomorrow. And I think we're going to have a lot of sellouts. So 10 a.m. tomorrow, tickets on sale. Sidewalk sale in downtown Glen Ellen afterward. Go downtown. It'll be a fun day. So next week, we hope to see you back outside, and we are going to pick a winner here, and this winner gets a $100 gift certificate from L.L. Bean and kayak lessons. And the winner is Ginny Coletta from, Ginny, you're right there. Ginny Coletta. Here you go, Ginny. Can we pass this back? Ginny, who are you going to take kayak lessons with? All right, everybody, thank you so much for coming. A big thank you to our friends from France. What an honor it is to have you here and a pleasure. Welcome, come back anytime. And just so you know, all of us are coming to visit next summer. Have a good time, everybody. Maestro Muspratt.
So ladies and gentlemen, I want to say hello to some people. All of you people who are over in the Playhouse Theater over there watching us on a big screen TV because you couldn't get seats tonight, aloha, okay? And thank you for coming, we appreciate it, okay? So I just wanted to say hello to them. As all of you who come to our concerts regularly know, each concert that we give, we try to showcase a young person from our community. Somebody who's practiced hard, who loves music, who has a good teacher, whose parents have dedicated time and energy to help them become a good musician. And tonight we have a young man named John, and I want to read his bio to you. His name is John Ogan. It said, John began playing the piano when he was 4 years old. John says about piano playing, I have found this incredibly fascinating art form, a complex way to express myself. John's hope is to be accepted at the Music Institute at Ravinia. As a toddler, he remembers attending CSO concerts at the Ravinia grounds, and some of his earliest memories are being held up at the pavilion so he could see the orchestra before him. He has attended the School of Ballet at Dance West for 8 years. He enjoys writing poetry and performing Shakespeare as one-act radio plays. He's in his second year of being a volunteer historical interpreter at Napier Settlement. His other passions include archaeology, paleontology, history, astronomy, kayaking, and anything Harry Potter, okay? Would you please welcome John?
I have a little story about John. 2 years ago, John came to audition for the competition, and I noticed some things about his articulation and about his the fingering and the way he was approaching the piano. So I asked him some questions, and I talked to his mom a little bit. And his mom said, oh, I said, what's his piano like at home? And he goes, oh, we have an electric piano. Now, there are some electric pianos that have really wonderful actions, and there are some that don't. And I asked her, and it was just like, look, 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 look. So, of course, you can't learn to play the piano. So Paula and I, and this is what we tried to do up here, each one of us in our own way. Paula and I put our heads together, and we thought, where is there in this lovely set of towns, great here, a person who doesn't want their wonderful piano anymore, and we could give it to John and his mom. And so it finally happened last year, and this wonderful subscriber who comes to all of our concerts didn't want her piano anymore because it was taking up room. It's a really good piano. And we put the two moms together, and they exchanged, and now John has a piano at home. Yeah. So I hope it's one of the reasons that you donate to the orchestra and you care about us, because we are involved in the community. You know, there's so many fantastic teachers here in this orchestra, and they're the bedrock of, like, the future of music, of course. I have to ask you a personal question right now. Has the piano gone yet? Are Charlie and Mike over there with their basses? No? Okay, I'll tell you a story then. I'll tell you about Verdi. Okay. So the next piece you're going to hear is the overture to Nabucco. Nabucco was written in 1841, yes, when Verdi was just 28 years old. And up until that time, he had nothing but flops. Okay, every opera that he wrote, he's a young composer. And the other sad thing is, in the year before this, his young wife and his two small children had died of, like, diseases of those times. So Verdi was ready to just cash it all in. He had a friend who one day brought him a libretto to a biblical theme, Nabucco, and he saw it, and he started writing, and it became his great hit that launched his career. So you'll hear Va Pensiero in the beautiful oboe and clarinet duet, and it is Fly and Think, and it's almost like the second national anthem now in Italy. People sing it constantly. So how are the bass players doing? Charlie and Mike, you okay? Okay, here we go. Mark, would you mind tuning the orchestra with Ricardo, please? Ben Nadel is our associate conductor. He's a hardworking, serious musician. He has a wonderful musical background. He's a terrific conductor. I think he has a wonderful future ahead of him. The orchestra loves him. Okay, I just want to tell you that. They love him way more than they love me. Okay. Okay, and for good reason. And he's also just a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful guy. Please welcome him.
Thank you.
As Diana mentioned to you, next year is going to be this amazing and comprehensive exhibit of famed Mexican artist Frida Kahlo. And we wanted to be a part of this. So next year in April, we're going to do an entirely Mexican Hispanic concert full of gorgeous Hispanic music. One of the composers that we're going to feature is the Mexican composer Agustin Lara, a very prolific and famous songwriter and composer. You might know this piece. It's called Granada. I promised you that we would do some musicals on the program. So I want to take you back to a time at the beginning of the century when operetta was becoming musicals, really. One of the champions of this was that great Irish genius, Victor Herbert, who was trained in Europe and came to America. And as soon as he got to New York, they hired him as the principal cello and the Metropolitan Opera, and after they saw him conduct a little bit, he became the first music director of the Pittsburgh Symphony. He wrote 43 musicals, 43. This one opened in Knickerbocker Theater on Christmas Day, 1905, and it was a smash hit. From that day until the end of July, it was performed 202 times. It was a hit. He was a rich Irishman, come to America, right? So the operetta is called, or the musical is called Mademoiselle Modiste, okay? The plot is very simple, and what probably every lady in the audience can totally relate to. Poor shop girl wants to become famous opera singer. Okay, so that's it. Catherine is going to come and sing this song for all of us. It's called Kiss Me Again. Would you welcome Catherine, please?
Thank you.
She's coming back. Come hear her in the opera. Yeah? So as I try to celebrate things that go on in our lives, I don't want us to forget that 60 years ago, in 1959, a guy named John Williams wrote his very first piece of film music, 60 years ago. One of my favorite composers and guy is in the world, just an amazing person. And you know, it's hard to start because he had to orchestrate, he played piano in Peter Gunn, he played for all the studios, but nobody would give him his own first film. So finally in 1959, he got his own first film, this astonishing travelogue that extolled the beauties and amazing, exciting times of going to Newfoundland. Really look it up. For the people from France, it's kind of over by you guys up there, like, it's very lush and good for sunbathing. Okay. So young Johnny Williams got his start, and then, you know, he did go on, you know, as we know. So he's written over 150 films, and I think one of them, did he write Star Wars? He did. Yeah, I think he did. So maybe we'll play Luke and Leia for you. His name is also Matthew, but he doesn't drink. So I promised you some pops music, yes? You want all different, you want Verdi and pops music. This is a little bit like New Year's Eve. If you haven't been to New Year's Eve, it's more fun. And there is champagne. There is. And cookies. I don't know. Cookies of French, okay? N'est-ce pas? Okay, so let's see. Pop music. We know, we've established this evening that from the country of Canada, there are many astonishing musical geniuses and talented artists. I think we have, and not me. I'm just a goober guy. But there's a woman, Celine Dion. Celine Dion. Yeah, oui? Okay. And she just retired last month from a 16-week run in Las Vegas. Over 70 shows a year. Wow is right. Absolutely right, sir. Wow. And imagine doing that every night and everybody excited. Yeah, wow. Yes, sir. Yeah. I mean, you know that she was paid $500,000 a show? No, that's wow. He said, yeah. So, donors, if you want, I can sing in Francais. You know, there's no problem, you know, for 500 grand a night, you know, and I'll conduct too. So we're going to do your piece right now from 1984, I think. It's by a guy named Huey Lewis. Yeah, good. And yeah, it's called The Power of Love. Would you welcome Catherine? Here we go. Catherine wants to know if I'm paying her 500 grand a night. Not for this gig, but for the operetta. We're going to do it. Okay, just so you know. As I look in your eyes. I could do that. I could do it. I know I could do that. So we're going to play you a piece by, I told you there'd be some film music, there has been already, but this is, I also want you to know that when you come and say hello to me afterwards, and I hear from 10 people, oh, this was my favorite piece, or 2 years ago, 3 years ago, we did a piece, and they're playing, please, 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 will you do this piece? So this is actually a request piece. You asked me for this piece many times, and so we're going to do it. It's written by a gentleman named Elmer Bernstein, who until recently had written more scores than anybody except John Williams. In his 82 years, he wrote 148 films. And he wrote things like The Ten Commandments and The Great Escape and To Kill a Mockingbird and Animal House. Yes, and Ghostbusters. Okay, so, this is a Western. You may have seen it or heard about it from 1960. It is called The Magnificent Seven. Who said that? Did this gentleman say that? You did not? Who said that? Whoever said that, come up here. I want to give you a prize. Okay, great. I'm glad you did that. Magnificent Seven, are you ready? Are you ready? Thank you. Before I say goodnight to you, I certainly want to express my appreciation on behalf of all of my colleagues up here to all of the donors and subscribers and people who help keep this orchestra not only healthy, but growing and getting better and more wonderful all the time. So thank you very, very much. Thank you. And I want to thank the production crew here at the MAC, everybody who's worked so hard all day. It was 175 degrees outside, and they had to go and do all sorts of things you can't even imagine just to make everything work. The crew has been just magnificent, and all the production people here at our beautiful theater. And I also would like to, and I think I should, I'd really like to thank the orchestra. So. That was wonderful. Thank you so much for that. They all feel that very much. So tell you a secret, because your applause was so wonderful. This next piece we're going to play on New Year's Eve, okay? It's by Johnny Williams, okay? It's from a film that he wrote called Far Away, and it's a bunch of Irish brawling music and beautiful Irish laments. And it is a great showcase for this fantastic orchestra. So stay cool, come back. Thank you so much, and I hope you have a wonderful, wonderful evening. Thank you, we've enjoyed playing for you.
No.